some folk to get right with God, because God has orchestrated every one of my steps. The steps of a good man is ordered by the Lord. All of my steps in the Lord. All of my steps in your word. You got to tell God to order your steps. Then in Genesis 22, I'm done. It's like Batman and Robin. This will be continued. I can't do it all. Genesis 22. God says to Abraham, take your only son, thine only son Isaac, take him out to Mount Moriah and offer him up as a sacrifice. Mind you, Isaac is no little boy. Isaac is somewhere between the age of 20 to 23 years old. He's older than what we think he is. And his father is leading him to Mount Moriah. They're carrying wood, fire, and a knife. And Isaac says to his father, where's the sacrifice? Where's the sacrifice? And Abraham said, oh boy, don't worry, the Lord will provide himself a lamb. And the Lord gives Abraham instructions. He puts the wood on the altar, and he says, now put your son Isaac on the altar. And I want you to take out your knife, and I want you to slay him. And Abraham, in his commitment to God, his obedience to God, he lays Isaac on the altar, and he takes his knife. And when he goes up, God says, hold up, Abraham. He said, look over in the thicket. There's a ram caught in the bush. Come on, somebody. God got your ram in the bush, and you just got to obey God. You don't understand. And the ram is a fat ram. Folk don't want to talk about the ram. He ain't no skinny ram on crack, amen. This is a fat lamb, amen, that gonna take care of the whole family, amen. He gonna dress the family. He gonna clothe the family. He gonna feed the family. He gonna put the family in the house, because God has a ram. Abraham is committed to God, to obey God. And the ram is caught in the thicket. And this is what Abraham says, Jehovah Jireh. He called the name of the place Jehovah Jireh, which means God will provide. But you gotta trust him. You gotta trust God. Most of us in this building, who's above the age of 50, know what it's like to trust God. We went through some hard times, especially our parents, but they trusted God. And we saw God work miracles, and he's still working them now. Folk were committed to God. I want to say this and I'm done. This is to every member of ministry. Recommit your life to God. Listen to what I said. Recommit your life to God. Not to the church building. But recommit your life to God. I was assessing an inventory of my life, and I thought I was doing pretty good. But when I began to look at the amount of time I spent in the presence of God versus where I spent everywhere else, it was nothing. I was giving God my leftovers. And sometimes I was too tired to give him good leftovers. So I started getting up fresh early in the morning. As the songwriter would say, early in the morning when you hear my voice. Good morning, Holy Spirit. Thank you for waking me this morning. Thank you for taking care of my family. Start talking to God early in the morning. Before your day becomes a hustle and a bustle. Talk to him about the day. And you said in Psalm 118 and 24, this is the day that the Lord has made. And I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. So because of the day you made, I need to get my agenda from you today. What do you want me to do today? What do you want me to do? So when we commit and we obey, there's blessings and benefits. I believe it's Psalm 103 and 2. He says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget. See, God would give him benefits before you had a job. If you ask anybody here right now, why do you work? Come on. Benefits. Benefits. Nobody wants to work a job where there are no. You don't want to serve a God where there is no benefits. So all of us want benefits. Want to be able to work long enough, get old enough, so we can get our retirement or our benefits. But God has other benefits other than a health insurance plan. A 401k. All of those are needful. You need that. But you also need benefits from God. The next verse, and I'm done. I got to sit down. Look at what God does. There's a TH on the end of the word forgive. That means God knows we're going to continue to sin. And he forgiveth all. See, iniquity takes on another word. It deals with evil. It deals with just shrewdness and all kind of stuff. He ain't talking about just sin. He's talking about all kind of dirty stuff. He forgives all of that. And then he says, that's a TH on that word. That means he continues to heal all of our diseases. The next verse. Number four, he says, who redeemeth, oh my God, your life. If you've almost been there, you need to know he redeemed your life from destruction. Then he crowns you. See, God said, now look, once I do all this for you, you got to be kind. You got to be tender to one another. You got to demonstrate mercy. According to Michael 6 and 8, we've got to love mercy, do justice, and walk humbly before our God. One translation says, treat people right. Demonstrate mercy and trust God. That's what he says. And so when God has done all this for us, amen, he gives us loving kindness and tender mercies. I think about mercy like this. If you were in court, now you know you're wrong. Your Honor, I'm throwing myself at the mercy of the court. Now, the judge has the power to pardon you or to demonstrate mercy or exact justice. And in most cases, sometimes the judge is lenient and he shows mercy. So when someone shows you mercy, you've got to show mercy to someone else. Be kind, affectionate, one toward another. And let's not be mean-spirited toward each other. Church, listen to me. You don't have to like me to love me. You're commanded to love me. And you listen. You can't go to heaven not loving me. If you hate me, you can't go to heaven. And you say what you want. You're not gonna be up in heaven praising God, talking about, I can't stand her. No, baby, you ain't got no praise like that in heaven. When you get to heaven, you gonna be happy you're there. That's the first thing, amen. You ain't gonna have time to talk about, I don't like them. Because I know sometimes I get upset. You get upset with folk, but I told God to help me. I want to miss my blessing because of you. I'm not going to hell because of you. You you don't work that much to me. I'm not going to be like Moses because you won't act right. I'm not going to smack the rock. I'm not going to hit the rock. I'm going to keep talking to the rock. Amen. The rock going to give me the word if I do what God said. I'm not going to lose my blessing and not get in the promised land because of hard-headed folk. Moses got so upset. He got that upset and hit the rock. And God said, okay, since you won't do what I say, you ain't going in the promised land. So I'm going to let you do it. I'm going to let you look over it, but you ain't going in. And sometimes that's what happens to us. Get frustrated in life. And life is filled with disappointments and frustration. In the middle of the word, life is if. Life is iffy. But you got to make a commitment to God. Gotta make a commitment. Maybe there's somebody here today who's not made a commitment of quality to God. But it's also